We hope you enjoy this message by Pastor Olubi Johnson.
Amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to continue our study in the book of Romans. In our last lesson, we ended with Romans chapter 3. And basically, what Paul was teaching us in that scripture was that we are made righteous by faith. Now, there are two aspects of righteousness which sometimes we don't differentiate. There is the right standing with God, that is to stand before God without a sense of guilt or condemnation. That right standing with God is only achieved by faith in the blood of Jesus, because it is Jesus' blood that cleanses us from every sin based on the sufferings that he partook on our behalf, both the physical sufferings on the cross and probably more importantly the sufferings he suffered in hell. The Bible says, "You will not leave my soul in hell, nor suffer thy Holy One to see corruption." Jesus' sufferings were not physical alone. Physical sufferings could not have paid the price for our sins, which are spiritual. And that's why he not only died on the cross, a shameful and painful death, but on top of that, when he left, his spirit left his body, that's why I said, "Father, Father, why have you forsaken me?" Because God actually turned his back on him, you know, for those 3 days. So his spirit went to hell. It went down, you know, to hell. And it was the sufferings that he suffered there for those 3 days that was not credited to our account. So any human being who now believes in Jesus, his sins that he has committed, the punishment for his sins are credited or taken from the punishment that Jesus suffered. Consequently, that person now becomes guiltless. He now becomes free. He now has right standing with God. And so we have right standing with God by faith in Jesus' death, his sufferings, and his death and burial. Now, also, the blood of Jesus is an ongoing, continuous flow, cleansing flow that continually cleanses us from sin. So, like I said last week, all our past sins, present sins, and future sins have already been covered because of Jesus' sacrifice. And that's why when he rose again from the dead on what we call Easter morning, he went into the heavenly holy of holies. That's when Mary saw him and she said, "Don't touch me. I've not ascended to my Father and to your Father." You know, and he went up, you know, that morning with his own blood and went into the heavenly holy of holies, the temple in heaven, and shed, you know, sprinkled his blood like the Old Testament priest used to do on the Day of Atonement. But the Old Testament priest did it every year, because in the Day of Atonement, all the blood of the animals could only cover sin. It could not remove it. But Jesus' blood, let's give the Lord a clap offering, somebody, doesn't just cover sin, it removes it. And so when he went to the heavenly holies, he made that blood available, you know, sprinkled it on the furniture in the heavenly holies, which was just the original of the copy that Moses made in the tabernacle of Moses. And since that day till today, as I speak, any human being who believes in Jesus, accepts him as his Savior and Lord, that blood avails for you. It cleanses you from sin, puts you in right standing with God, and subsequently, even if you sin after that, it keeps you in right standing. It's a continuous thing. It's very important to understand that. The second aspect is right doing. Now, this is one that, again, is not very familiar with a lot of Christians. You know, many, many Christians till date are trying to keep the Word of God by the flesh. What do we mean by the flesh? It's very important that we define our terms properly. What we mean by the flesh is he's trying to do it by natural human strength, which is tainted by the sin nature. The sin nature is still in the soul and the body, even of born-again Christians. When we get born again, the sin nature is removed from our spirits. So our spirits now have access. The Bible says the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is life, or has life, or better still, has access to the life of God because of righteousness, because of right standing, because of the cleansing of the blood of Jesus. Your connection with God, like an umbilical cord. The Bible says Christ is the vine, we are the branches. So we are connected together. We're connected directly to God. That's what happens when you get born again. You become a branch of the vine. You are immersed into Christ. You are joined together with Christ in the Spirit. Now, the connection between you and God can get blocked. When you sin. So when you confess your sins, the blood of Jesus Christ goes into operation, and it cleanses, it totally removes that sin nature, so that the life of God can begin to flow back, you know, in full measure. Now, with that right standing as a foundation, you can now move to right doing. Now, if you try and do the Word of God with the sin nature still in the soul, the mind, the will, and the emotions, and inside the physical body, that everything you do will be tainted by that sin nature. And that's why the Bible says our righteousness is as filthy rags in the sight of God. Yeah, you might have a sincere heart. You may, you know, you may be, you know, zealous and all of that, but it's not acceptable because it's being done by the natural power of man. Is being done by man's natural strength and ability, which still has the nature of sin inside. So what God has done in his wisdom is that by giving us this right standing with God, he makes available to us the life of God. So that life of God now goes into our spirit, you know, what I call the lower, the lower belly of your spirit, which is, you know, really down here, and then it moves up from there into the, you know, higher portion of your belly, and then into your chest. And the way you now speak God's word, like for example, if you say, "I endure long and I'm patient and kind," then the power that's coming from those words is not from the sin nature anymore; it's from the divine nature. So the power to do, to endure long and to be patient and kind, now comes from God and from the Holy Spirit. And it is that power that now enables you to endure long and be patient and kind. You're not doing it. You are now doing it not by the flesh, but by the Spirit. Whereas a person who is either not born again or is born again and he is not operating by faith, he tries to endure long. He tries to be patient and kind. But his efforts are, you know, tainted, and his efforts are actually, those efforts are actually aborted. Even though he's sincere, his efforts are aborted by the sin nature that is inside his flesh. So that's why Paul said, "I want to do the thing. I want to do it, but I find something else not allowing me to do it. You know, my efforts to endure long and I'm patient and kind, you know, is frustrated." That's the word I'm looking for. By that sin nature, and all of us have experienced that. You know, you say, "Yeah, you want," and then you just find you're not patient, and you didn't endure long, and you certainly were not kind. Praise the Lord. Is that anybody? Give me a wave offering, you know. Praise the Lord. And that's what happens. That's why you cannot do it by natural human strength alone. That natural human strength, there's nothing wrong with your flesh. There's nothing wrong with your mind. But the sin nature is inside. So what you do is you put the divine nature into the mind, into the will, mind, emotions. You put it into the flesh. Then when you now act, It will now no longer be by the sin nature. It will now be by the divine nature. That's why Zechariah said, "Not by might." Hello, somebody. "Not by power." How? "But by my spirit, saith the Lord." So we have to learn, you know, by practice. And Jesus himself learned this. You know, the Bible says he learned obedience by things which he suffered. You know, he suffered self-denial to be able to make sure that everything he did, he operated it by the Spirit, even though he was tempted, you know, by the sin nature, the prince of the power of the air. He came, Bible says, he was tempted in every way like as we are. So that pressure from outside came against him. It came against his mind. It came against his flesh, you know. But then what was inside him, the divine nature that was inside him by the power of the Holy Spirit was stronger. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. And it overcame that pressure from the outside. And he did that consistently. He was tempted in every way like as we are, yet without sin. So we have to learn it too. So you've got to learn that when you now want to be endure long and you're patient and kind, you're not going to do it just by human effort. You have to. The way you do it is you first of all say it. You have to receive the divine nature, you know, through the word of God. You know, in the name of Jesus, I was saying, in Jesus' name we have life. Then I now say, I endure long and I'm patient and kind. Then I pray in the Spirit. I pray in tongues. Then when a situation comes up for me to endure long and patient and kind, it's like it's automatic. I am patient and I am kind. And I understand, oh, wow, I did it by the Spirit. I didn't do it by the flesh. And it's a continual practice. Like I shared in our Bible study, rather in our School of Perfection teaching, I think it was last Wednesday, Jesus said, I do always those things that are pleasing. And I said to us, I said, how did he do it? It's in Deuteronomy chapter 30. He said, the word is nigh thee in thy heart and in thy mouth that thou mayest do it. By taking the power of God into your heart through his word and saying it with your mouth, you release the power of the Holy Spirit to do the word of God. But when you don't say it and you don't have it in your heart and you just try and do it, you do it by the flesh. And so right standing is by faith in the blood of Jesus. Watch this. And right doing is by faith in the word of God. You see, there are different agents. We're going to see this probably in my main message later on today. Each thing has its work that it's doing. There is a work the blood is doing that the word is not doing. Although the knowledge of the blood comes from the word. So it all still comes back to God's word. And then there's a work the power of the Holy Spirit is doing that's being superimposed on the word that you speak. So it's not just to say God's word alone. The letter killeth, but the Spirit gives life. So it's this power of the Holy Spirit that's going to make the word that you speak effective, that will now make your obedience effective. So it's clear, it's vital. So, you know, so we have both, everybody say, both right standing and right doing are accomplished only by faith, not by human works. You see, under the Old Testament, God set up a system which was actually destined to fail. And God knew it was going to fail. But he set it up for one reason. We see this in the book of Galatians later on. You know, to let man know that there is nothing you can do physically that can make you in right standing with me. So he gave them this long list of ceremonial things that they did. They would kill animals and they would take the blood to the priest and then they would wash and then they all kinds of, you know, diverse washings and all of that. And nobody could keep all of those things. No, nobody. God knew they couldn't keep it. And God was trying to point the attention to the fact that a Savior, a Messiah is coming and it is only by faith in him you'll be able to do these things. You cannot do these things, you know, just by these physical, you know, ceremonies and observances. So the smart ones, or let me use a better word, the honest ones amongst the children of Israel, by the time they practiced those things for a few years, they said, this can't work. Then God would lead them now by the Spirit, those who were honest, you know, to Deuteronomy. Because God told Moses the answer from way back then. You know, and the ones that actually did well amongst them did it by faith. Even though they performed the animal sacrifices and they did all of those things because it was required by law, they understood that you could not please God by those animal sacrifices. And that's why I think it's David who said, you know, sacrifice and offering, you know, you have no pleasure in them. You know, I can do it. You know, I can. He said, when he sinned, you know, with Bathsheba, he said that, you know, I would have given sacrifice. But a broken and a contrite heart, thou will not despise. He understood that those physical ceremonies, even though they had their place in the Old Testament, wouldn't get the job done. It was the honest ones among them. So all the guys we see who were very successful in the Old Testament, they all operated by faith. Whether it's Enoch, where, you know, even this was before the law, whether it's Abraham, we're going to see that today, you know, whether it's Moses, Joshua, all the guys who did well understood they had to operate by faith. The other people who were hypocritical and were dishonest were trying to keep, you know, please God by keeping the law, you know, and that's why they became not only hypocrites, they also became legalistic. And condemned other people. That's what happened to the Pharisees. You know, they say, oh, you didn't wash your hand. You didn't. And Jesus said, no. It's not all that. It's not all these diverse washings and all that. That's not what makes you righteous. Ceremonial law will not make you righteous. It will only point to you the fact that it was a pointer to the fact that all these sacrifices we're doing, a real great sacrifice is coming. And all of these are just a picture and a pointer to that final sacrifice. The ones who amongst them who understood this, they did excellently in the Old Testament. That's why I have people like, you know, one of the best examples, of course, is Daniel, which I mentioned recently. Daniel had no temple. All those years, Daniel was taken when he was a young boy. Maybe he was about 16, 17, when he was taken captive. And he lived till maybe about 100, you know, we're told, you know. Hebrew history tells us that his age is not recorded in the Bible. And all of those years, not one animal sacrifice. Because the temple had been destroyed in Jerusalem. There was all those ceremonial rituals were not being done while he was in Babylon. Yet, Daniel was one of the most spiritual men. How did he do it? Spiritual law. He understood that it's not the animal sacrifices and all of that. But he would pray three times a day. At the time of the morning sacrifice, where they normally would kill the animal, Daniel would be praying. At the time of the afternoon sacrifice, Daniel would be praying. You know, and the Bible says he had an excellent spirit and no error or fault was found in him because he did it by the Spirit. Even though in the Old Testament, they were not born again on the inside, but the Spirit from the outside, you know, superimposed on his words and his actions, his soul, body, and circumstances, caused him to please God. And so we New Testament Christians, we need to understand this. And in our own case today, one of the things that really hinders us is what I call a lot of legalistic things. For instance, you know, when we first got born again, you know, 40, 50 years ago, you know, there was a lot of legalism. There still is, just that it's a little bit different now. You know, thinking that, oh, you're righteous by what you wear. So if you wear a particular kind of dress, then people say, yes, this is a righteous, this is a serious Christian. If you don't wear this, you know, this is not a serious Christian. If you wear gold or earrings, you know, no, you can't be, you know, because the Bible says, you know, not the putting on of gold and all of that. But if you read the scripture properly, that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about an attitude. Because we know that Sarah and Rebecca wore gold, praise the Lord. So there was nothing wrong with gold. It's just that if you now make gold the center of your life and you spend all your time and money and strength and then that gold now becomes an idol, you know, the same thing with your clothing, the same thing with your hairdo. That, you know, he wasn't saying you shouldn't do your hair. He wasn't saying you shouldn't wear clothes. He wasn't saying you shouldn't wear gold. But he was saying that if you make that the main thing in your life and you begin to neglect spiritual things, then those things now become evil. But whereas, if you now take that as, oh, if I don't wear gold and I don't wear this and I don't wear that, that's what makes me righteous, you've gone back to the Old Testament. You're just using another set of human physical things. So, no physical human activity, so to speak, you know, can make you righteous. Understand it. What makes you righteous, number one, is the blood of Jesus. Number two is the Word of God, and it's by faith. All righteousness in the New Testament is by faith. Even in the Old Testament, it was also by faith. It's just that it's much clearer now in the New Testament. So, that's why in verse 31, he says, of chapter 3, he says, do we then make void the law through faith? Certainly not. I'm reading New King James. Let me go back to King James. I do some meditations in the New King James. It says, do we then make void? I didn't hear you. The law through faith? God forbid. Yea, we establish the law. Now, keep it in its context. The law he's talking about here is the Ten Commandments and the moral law. He's not talking here about all the ceremonial laws. Those ones were done away with. But we're still under, the Ten Commandments are still in force today. It's still wrong to steal. It's still wrong to kill. It's still wrong to commit adultery. It's still wrong to covet. You know, all those things are still in force. So what, when we're, by faith now, we do not make the law void. Rather, we establish it. We actually say, yes, the law is right. And we can now do it by faith. Glory be to God. Now, chapter 4. What shall we say then? I didn't hear you. That Abraham our father, as pertaining to the flesh, hath found. This is just an expansion of whatever they have just explained, you know. And it's good I put that foundation. So when I talk about Abraham now, you'll perfectly understand what God is talking about and how Abraham became justified. For if Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before God. In other words, if what made Abraham righteous, what gave him his right standing with God, was by killing one animal or doing this or doing that, then he can boast. But he wasn't. For what saith the scripture? Verse 3. I didn't hear you. Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. His right standing with God was not based on any human physical activity. It was based on faith. He believed God. Now, Jesus hadn't yet come, so he couldn't believe in Jesus yet. But he believed what God told him. God said, look at the stars, and if you can count them, so your seed will be. And the Bible said, and Abraham looked and he believed. And then God said, I count that to you as righteousness. Because the faith, the ultimate righteousness that's going to come is also going to come by faith. So by showing faith in believing my word about the stars, when the time comes, you will believe when my word says Jesus died for you. Now, to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. Now, if your right standing comes by doing something, then and what you do is accepted, then God owes you something. So it's a debt. He said, but this righteousness we're talking about, he has nothing. You don't do anything. You only believe. So this righteousness now comes by favor. It doesn't come by works. You're not being paid for what you did. Somebody else paid the price. His name is Jesus. You can never pay the price yourself. So it's not reckoned of grace, but of debt. But to him, I didn't hear you, that worketh not, but he doesn't do any work, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Your faith in God's word and what Jesus did is now reckoned to you as righteousness. It's not based on any physical activity that you could have done or anything you've done. Even as David also describeth, I didn't hear you, the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works. The works he's talking about here is the works of the Old Testament and any physical activity that you can try and do. You know, your right standing is not based on works. Are works important? They have their place, and there's a reward for them. And even those works have to be done by faith, like I explained earlier on. You know, but as far as right standing is concerned, it can never be by works. Understand that it will set you free as a Christian. Your righteousness is based on your faith in the blood of Jesus. It's not based on what you do. It's not based on how well you prayed. It's not based on the fact that you come to church every Sunday. It's not based that you pay your tithes. It's not based on anything that your nothing you do can give you right standing. The only thing that gives you right standing is faith in the blood of Jesus. Now, when you now have the right standing, you can now get life and power through prayer and confession and praying in the Spirit. And then you can now do a lot of good things. Those good things are important and you'll be rewarded for that at the resurrection. You know, but your right standing is never based on works. It's crucial. It's a stronghold in our minds. You see, many people come to God and say, oh, I've done this and I've done that and I've done it, like Job. That was one of Job's problems. Job came to God with faith and confidence in what he had been doing, in his works. His works weren't good enough. And God was trying to correct him and say, look, you need to operate by faith. And it was when he started operating by faith and Job prayed, and then God turned his captivity. He understood now that this thing is by spiritual law. It's not by physical law. It's not by physical actions. So, in verse 6, he says, the God imputed righteousness without works. Say, verse 7, blessed is the man, but blessed are they, thank you, Prof. Blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. Observe, the man sinned, though. He didn't say the man did not sin. But he said that God did not impute sin to him. In other words, the record of his sin, the record of his sin has been completely removed. God has imparted righteousness to him, even though he sinned, his sins have been forgiven, not because he did the right thing, but because he believed. Cometh, I love this, verse 9. Cometh this blessedness, then upon the circumcision only. Understand, circumcision in the New Testament, and many times when in Paul's writings, he's talking about the Jews. Because the Jews, once you're born a natural Jew, on the eighth day, you're circumcised, and that brings you to the covenant of Abraham. So he's talking here about Jews who are physically circumcised. Or upon the uncircumcision also. In other words, this righteousness by faith, is it available only to the Jews who are circumcised? Or is it also available to the Gentiles who are not circumcised? Back in the olden days, the Gentiles were not circumcised. Even today, in some European countries, they're not circumcised. People circumcise today not because of covenant of Abraham, for health reasons. It's just wise to circumcise, you know, the foreskin of the flesh, you know. For we say that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. I love this reasoning. This guy, God gave him great insight. You know, he's a lawyer, you know, and he understood the legal basis. That's why Paul was ahead in this understanding of all the other apostles. They grew up, and Paul too, they grew up as Jews, all of them, including Paul. They grew up with the covenant of Abraham. They grew up going to this temple, making animal sacrifices, you know, not eating unclean foods, you know, with diverse washings. So that mentality that you are righteous because, see, what makes me, because I went to Jerusalem at Passover, I went again at Pentecost, I went again at Tabernacles, I sacrificed my animals, I washed my hands, you know, all the things they told us to do, I've done them, you know, I don't eat, you know, unclean food, you know, I don't mix with Gentiles. They thought that was what made them righteous. And even after they got born again, they still carried that mentality. That was the reason why they had that clash at Antioch. Peter knew this thing because Jesus had taught them. You know, but you know, old habits die hard. And he felt, you know, he was a stronghold in his mind that what made me righteous was these ceremonial observances of animal sacrifices, not eating unclean food and all of that. That's why when God was going to send him to Cornelius' house, God had to give him a vision. Because that mentality was still there. And he saw all kinds of unclean animals. The sheet was let down from heaven 3 times. He said, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." He said, "Lord, you must be kidding. You know now, Lord, you know. No unclean thing has ever passed my lips. You know, you're trying to make me unclean." He was giving God a lecture. You know, but God understood. He was pulling down a stronghold in his mind. And then God told him, he said, "What I have cleansed, don't call it common." So when he now went to Cornelius' house and they were Gentiles, ordinarily he would not have gone. Can you imagine? And you need to understand, if you study church history, you know, and that's why when you're studying your Bible, if you have a good Bible, you know, good Bible, you can see the dates at the top. If you have a good study Bible, you know, this was almost 20 years after Pentecost. That mentality was still there. He didn't want to go. He wouldn't have gone. If God didn't give him that vision, he would never have gone. It was the vision. And God said, "I've sent 3 men. They come from me. Go with them. Nothing doubt." God knew his mindset. And so when he got there, you know, and the Holy Ghost fell, he said, now God has shown me I should not call any man common. And he justified them. You know, he said, "Can we stop water?" That's why God had to get them filled with the Holy Spirit, even though they would have debated whether they should get them baptized. You know, and then later on in Antioch, you know, when Paul came, you know, when he came, he was eating with the Gentiles because he knew he was free. Then when some people came from James in Jerusalem, you know, in order to make them feel that he's still righteous in the Jewish way, you know, he started withdrawing from the Gentile believers. And Paul said, "Wow, Peter, you can't do that. What are we trying to say? That, you know, that the Gentiles are not righteous because they're Gentiles, and we the Jews are the ones that are righteous?" He said, "You're not acting right." But understand, I understand it better now. It was a stronghold. It was a mindset that has been there for centuries, yea, millennia. They've been doing this thing from the time of Moses. All of them grew up like that, including Paul. But Paul, because of revelation, he understood now the difference. And so that's why he could write these letters, Galatians and Romans, for us to set us free. So he said, it wasn't only for the circumcision. No, it was also for the uncircumcision. For we say, the lower part of verse 9, that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. How? I love this. This is why you need to think deep inside the scripture. And I'm going to bring out something even in addition to what Paul has brought here that I've just seen recently when I was teaching, you know, a few weeks ago about the law of conscience. He said, how was it then reckoned? Was he in circumcision or in uncircumcision? This, you know, if you don't think deeply, your mind will just assume that, you know, he was in circumcision. Whereas he wasn't. Not in circumcision, but in uncircumcision. By the time God told Abraham that so your children will be, he was only 75. And he looked at the stars and he believed God. The Bible says he reckoned to him as righteousness. By that time, Abraham was not circumcised. And he was not going to be circumcised for another 24 years. So the righteousness was not reckoned because of the circumcision. It was not the circumcision that made him righteous. It was the faith. And that faith sustained him for 24 years. May God have mercy on us. He received, verse 11, and he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had yet being uncircumcised. He had the faith before he was circumcised. So the circumcision was only a seal of the faith he had had before he was circumcised. So it was not the circumcision that gave him his faith. In fact, it's the other way around. It's the faith that brought the circumcision. May God have mercy on us. Oh, I love this guy. He said, that he might be the father of all them that believe. That's why I like this thing Donald Trump has just done with Israel and the UAE. They call it the Abraham Accord. Abraham is the father of everybody. He's the father of the Christian. He's the father of the Jew. He's the father of the Muslim and the Arabs. And this is what Paul is saying here. He said that he might be the father of all. Everybody say all. Turn to your neighbor, say Jew, Christian, Arab. Of all them that believe, though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed unto them also. Paul is saying that these Gentile believers, Cornelius, all his household, Silas, I think Silas was Jewish, you know, Timothy, and all of these guys. He said, they're not circumcised, but the same way Abraham was made righteous by faith before he was circumcised, that's how Timothy has been made righteous. That's how Titus has been. So we don't have to circumcise them before they have faith. Now, if they want to be circumcised, they can be circumcised, but not as a... The circumcision is not what makes them righteous. Oh, God have mercy on us. That righteousness might be imputed on them also. And the father of circumcision, verse 12, to them that are not of the circumcision only, but who also walk, thank you, honey, in the steps of the faith that our father Abraham, which he had, being yet uncircumcised. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It means every Gentile who is not circumcised doesn't have to be circumcised. If he wants to be circumcised for health reasons, he can be. But he certainly has nothing to do with right standing. The right standing is solely and only by faith. That's what Paul... And Paul understood. That's why Paul was free with the Gentiles. He would eat with them. He would sleep. His closest disciples were Gentiles. Luke, Gentile. And you know, this is just for historical purposes, but it's important to understand. You know, they looked down on Paul, some of the early apostles. Peter didn't. Peter respected Paul, you know, so did John and some of the other ones. But some of the other people didn't. And the argument was this. Paul was not one of the 12. So who does he think he is? Number two, this guy's always going around with Gentiles. In fact, one of the things that they said in the Acts of the Apostles was, you know, when they wanted to kill him in Jerusalem, when he went back, you know, to go and, you know, and James called him and all the brethren, Peter, he said, you know, there are many of our people around. They are zealous for the law. So you know what you're going to do. You know, even though we all know that all the ceremonial things, they're not important anymore. But just to keep the peace, so that people will not fight and all of that, you know, that you are walking orderly. You know what? Take two people, go to the temple, shave your hair, you know, kill your animal, so that people will know. And Paul, you know, Paul was a very, very smart guy, you know, and an honest person. You know, he said in one place, he said, to the Jew, I became as a Jew. So he said, no problem. I know I sacrifice, I don't sacrifice, it doesn't mean anything. But I'll do it anyway, so that, you know, these other people will not be offended. And he did. He went to the temple, you know, shaved his head, you know, did all the things that they, all the normal things that they do, you know, in the temple. But in town, they saw Paul with these guys, you know, from who were Gentiles. So they assumed, it was wrong, that he had brought those Gentiles with him to the temple. They said, this is the man. The Bible said they threw dust in the air. And said, away with such a fellow from the earth. And they wanted to kill him. It was that Roman centurion who came to rescue him. The point is this. For years, even after they got born again, the stronghold of righteousness by works was still in the hearts and the minds of many Jews. And today in Christianity, the stronghold of righteousness by works is still in the mind of many Christians. Like I explained, you know, about dressing, you know, gold, you know, all kinds of things. You know, you wear something, but you don't believe you can't be righteous. Even some of us, let me bring it a little bit more home now. And what I'm about to say, I don't approve of it, but never use it as a yardstick of righteousness. You know, you see some Christians that have tattoo on their body. Even, you know, especially some of our white brethren. Now, some of them did that tattoo before they got born again. When they now got born again, some of those tattoos are permanent. You can't remove them. Now, I see a Christian, you know, and he's speaking in tongues and he has tattoo. he has this funny tomahawk here. You know, inside you, you know. That same thing the Jews had, you have it. Because you are now judging him based on the outside. Whereas his heart has been circumcised, has been made righteous by faith. The tattoo on the outside, the hair, doesn't change that. Now, of course, I'm not saying you're going to have tattoo. Do you understand? Because even God in the Old Testament said they shouldn't put tattoo on their body. You know, but some people have done it before they knew. Do we accept them? Of course we accept them. And some of those people are the apostles of tomorrow. There are some of those people that you will see them raise the dead. And you will see them do all kinds of great works for God. You must just take your eyes off the tattoo. Just like Peter had to take his eyes off the fact that they were not circumcised. Or they ate unclean food. It's the same mentality. Hallelujah. Verse 13. For the promise that he should be heir of the world. That's another message for another day. Do you know that what we have in Jesus Christ through Abraham, if he be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. What God has actually, our inheritance is actually the whole world. You know why? By the time you inherit the Spirit without measure, literally you have inherited the world. Literally. Because there's really nothing in this world you can't get. You know what he said? He said about the Lord Jesus Christ. He said that, you know, I think in Psalm 110 or Psalm 2, I can't remember exactly which one, where he says that, give me the nations for my inheritance. But how do I get the nations? Spirit without measure. So, when he made the promise to Abraham, you know, the promise he made to Abraham was that, because you have done this, you know, he said, blessing will I bless you. He said, your seed will possess the gates of their enemies, you know, and in you, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. So that's what he means here. When he says that the promise he gave to Abraham that he should inherit all the nations of the world. Now, all the nations of the world will come to this knowledge of Jesus Christ through Abraham's seed. He didn't come by the works of the law. Was not to Abraham or to his seed, which is us, Jesus and then us by extension, through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. In other words, this promise, this great blessing that God blessed Abraham with, had nothing to do with the law of Moses. The law of Moses had not even been instituted. It had nothing to do with animal sacrifices and divers washings and all that. For if they, which are of the law, be heirs, faith is made void and the promise of non-effect. Oh my God. You have to understand what he's saying. And what he's saying is this. If the way I'm going to become an heir of the world is through the ceremonial observances of the law, then I don't need faith anymore. And if I don't need faith anymore, it means then I have to do all those works of the law perfectly, without any mistake, in order to inherit, and I can't do it. So the promise becomes of non-effect. Because it's impossible. No, it is impossible for anybody to keep the law. So if you move to the law, you automatically dissociate yourself from the promise. You cannot get the promise by the law. So the promise becomes of non-effect. For if they... Okay, we read that. Verse 15. We're going to close. But because... I didn't hear you. The law worketh wrath. For where there is no law, there is no transgression. Because you just won't do it properly. And when you don't do it properly, even if you just break one little tiny part of it, automatically you're guilty of all. And that brings the condemnation and the punishment of God upon you. So, the law is not the way to go. The way to go is faith. Praise the Lord. Therefore, oh glory to God, it is of faith that it might be, everybody scream it, by grace. I think I'm going to stop here, and then we'll take the, because the other part is so good, there's no way I can finish it this morning. Therefore it is of faith that it might be by grace to the end. The promise might be sure to some of the seed. You know what this scripture has just told us here? That anybody in Christ Jesus that will operate by faith, all the promises of God for him are sure. You know why? He's not doing it by his own power anyway. You see, it's not based on my natural ability. It's not based whether I'm naturally brilliant or I was born into the Johnson family. Or there is nothing in the natural that I have that can guarantee me that promise. It's only by faith. It's sure to everybody. He said that it might be sure to all the seed. Because God knew some people will be born with advantage, some people will be born with disadvantage. But it's going to be sure to all the seed. So he made it by faith. Not only to that which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. He's telling us here, I got to close. We're going to stop here in verse 16. That it is by faith to the Jew, it is by faith to the Gentile. Not only of the law, but he's the father of us all. He's the father of the people who are circumcised. He's the father of those who are not circumcised. All of us need to walk in the steps, we're going to look at that in our next lesson, of the faith of our father Abraham. He said a very important thing. He said that it might be by grace. What is grace? It's favor that causes God to give you a measure of divine life and power that you could not get by trying to do anything. And when you now believe in your heart, that's why it says, in thy heart and it's in thy mouth that thou mayest do it. Grace makes life. You see, this is Psalm 30, verse 5. He says, his favor is life. In 1 Peter chapter 3, he talks about being heirs together of the grace of life. Ever say grace of life? Oh, you didn't say it properly. Say it properly. It's 1 Peter chapter 3, it's in verse 7. The grace of life. You know what the grace of God does? It makes the life of God available. That's why it's called the grace of life. In the Greek, it reads like this. It is the charis of Zoe. In Greek, charis is grace. Life is Zoe. If this is one of the greatest clarity of revelation a Christian needs to understand. See, we say grace, 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 but we don't know what we're talking about. What is grace? It is favor that gives life. It is life that can now, through confession, through praying in tongues, that is converted to power, that now makes possible for you to do anything God wants you to do? On one hand, oh gosh, I'm going to blow your mind. And to get anything God wants you to get. Because everything God does, He creates it by that life and power. So by giving you grace that gives you life, God has given you all things. Stand to your feet. Hallelujah. According as His divine power have given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature. By the time we understand what eternal life is, we won't have any problem in our Christianity. See, the problem with Christians is that majority of Christians don't have a good understanding of eternal life. What God gave us by giving us Jesus, He said, I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. This grace of life is the greatest thing God could give. You know why? God gave us Himself. He literally gave you Himself and said, there's no point asking me for a car or asking me for a house or asking me for healing or asking me for a wife or asking me for his child or asking me for this. He said, I give you myself. Now create the wife, create the car, create the house, create it. Use that life, that my life inside you to make all those other things you want. That's it. Hallelujah. Let's talk to God. We continue our teaching in Romans chapter 4. In my last lesson, we stopped, I believe, about verse 16. And I just want to quickly review some of that. In verses 13 to 16, let's just read it again. It says, for the promise, I didn't hear you folks, that he should be heir of the world, was not to Abraham or to his seed. Now, every time in the Bible, particularly in the New Testament, whenever you read the seed of Abraham, always identify it as yourself. It's actually two things. Now, this is a very important concept in God's Word I'm about to tell you. I taught this many years ago. I think it was 1996. I first taught this, the concept of the manifold wisdom of God. You see, over the years, many people got into a lot of controversy because they'll say, oh, this is what I believe the Bible says, and this one says this is what I believe, and then they will disagree. And sometimes both of them are right. Because, see, in the manifold wisdom of God, there's not just one application. You see, like here, the seed here is talking about Jesus Christ, but he's also talking about us in him. Paul makes this clear in Romans chapter 3. He says, Galatians rather. He says that, and if ye be Christ, then are you Abraham's seed according to the promise. Yet, the same Paul says, the promise was not to seeds as in plural, but unto seed as in singular, because he was talking about Jesus Christ in particular. But because we are in him, everything that pertains to him pertains to us. So whenever you're reading the Bible, and you see anything about, Christ, he sees you. It's true about Jesus. Another example I can give of the manifold wisdom of God. For instance, and I was just meditating on this just today. I think it was early this morning or maybe yesterday. I can't remember when I was preparing for the service. And you know what it says? It says, out of Egypt I have called my son. But that scripture, watch this. It's true on three levels. God called natural Israel out of Egypt, didn't he? You know what he told Pharaoh? He said, Israel is my firstborn, my son. So out of Egypt, he called natural Israel. Then out of Egypt, he called the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you listening? Out of the Lord Jesus Christ, when he was a baby, they had to take him to Egypt because Herod was trying to kill all the children. Then you and I are spiritually born in Egypt because, Egypt is a type of the world. And then out of Egypt, he has also called us. So it's true of natural Israel. It's true of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's true of each and every one of us. Billions of us. Not one, not two, billions. billions of us, you know. So that's an example of the manifold wisdom of God. So that scripture, out of Egypt, was called my son. I have called my son. It's not only true of natural Israel. It was true of the Lord Jesus Christ. But it's not only true of Jesus Christ. It's true of every one of us. Many scriptures are like that in the Bible. It has that level of application to Jesus and then to you and I. You know, and you need to know that and believe God for that. That's why Paul went ahead to say, he said that all the promises of God in him are yea and in him are amen. You and I are in him. So all the promises of God in him are for you, they are yea, and for you they are what? That doesn't sound like a very convincing amen. So when you read things like the third day, I will be perfected, it's you. Hallelujah. After 2 days, I will revive them. In the third day, I will raise him up. It's you. There is no prophetic scripture about the Lord Jesus Christ that does not have an application to us. But you need the wisdom of God as to see how it applies to you and how you can appropriate it in our time. Amen. Okay. So, the promise that he should be heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law. It wasn't through the ceremonial observances that God gave to Moses. Abraham did not get the promise by keeping those ceremonial observances, even circumcision, and then later on all the animal sacrifices and the divers washings and all the protocol of the Levitical priesthood. That's what he's really talking about here. But through the righteousness of faith. For if they which are the law be heirs, then faith is made void and the promise of none effect. Because nobody could perfectly keep all of those Levitical protocols. So if you want to get righteousness through the Levitical protocol, you are doomed to failure. It's of none effect, you know, and rather it's faith is made void. And then the promise is made of none effect. That is, the promise cannot become a reality. You cannot inherit the promise. Because there's no way you can keep the Levitical protocols and ceremonial laws perfectly. Nobody has ever done it. The only person, even the Lord Jesus Christ, and he knew far better. He didn't try to keep all of those laws. One, he was sinless. So he never sinned, so he never had to go and make any sacrifices for himself. So that removed a whole lot of things. And then he kept the law, you know, the spiritual law, by keeping it in his mouth and in his heart and in his actions. And so he kept it perfectly. And then the few ones that he had to do, like go to Jerusalem every Passover, Pentecost, and time, he did that. And that's it, you know. And he knew better than to try and, you know, do righteousness. He knew that he had to be by faith, you know, through the power of God. He says, but because the law worketh wrath, for where no law is, there is no transgression. And we saw this last time. Therefore, it is of faith that it, this is one of the great statements of the New Testament, that it might be by grace. To the end that the promise might be sure to some of the seed. Because God made it by grace, it's not going to be by any human effort. So every human being, all the seed, both Gentile, Jew, Black, Grecian, you know, white, brown, is sure to everybody. Because you know why? None of them do it by themselves. All of them is done by grace through faith. So it does not matter what your natural shortcomings are, the disadvantages of your natural birth, like mommy was telling us last week, all of those things become disannulled by faith. Because by the grace of God, God's grace will overcome whatever natural limitations that you have. So there is nothing. There is no promise in God's word that is not sure to you. By grace through faith. Okay? And not to that only. I didn't hear you folks. Which is of the law. But to that also which is of the faith of Abraham. Who is the father of us all. In other words, Abraham is the father of all people who come to God through Jesus Christ. Whether you're Jewish, whether you're Gentile, you know, whether you're like President Trump has now done the Abraham Accord, you know, whether you're Arab, whether you're Muslim, it doesn't really matter. Abraham is the father of all of us, you know, if it's conditional, we walk in the steps of his faith. And that's it. And then I just want to reiterate one point. You see, Abraham was justified by faith before circumcision. We won't read that again. We saw this last week. It was not the circumcision that gave him the faith. He had the faith, and then the circumcision was now a seal of the faith that he had before he was uncircumcised. That means that people without circumcision can be justified without faith. That was the problem with Paul and Peter and the early, you know, the Jews in the early church. They felt that the Gentiles still had to be circumcised, you know, in order to be accepted. And God, Paul said, no. So he took people like Timothy, he got him circumcised, Titus, you know. But he said, I'm not circumcising them because they have to be justified. They're already justified by faith. And God really proved this, you know, wonderfully by getting the house of Cornelius, born again and spirit-filled, no circumcision. No circumcision. It's one of the most amazing acts in the New Testament. No circumcision. God did it deliberately, so that none of the Jews could say, oh, they are Gentiles, they need to you know, be circumcised, they need to come through the law of Moses, they need to be purified. No, God just bypassed all of that. And God then born again and filled with the Holy Spirit instantly, you know, by the word that Peter spoke. They didn't even say a sinner's prayer. And that's another point I want to make here. Now, take what I'm saying with a pinch of salt. The Bible says, in understanding, be men. If you lead people to Christ, take them through a sinner's prayer. You know, that is, you know, they believe Jesus died for their sins and he was raised again from the dead, from their justification. With the heart, man believeth with the mouth. That law is there. So we're not doing away with that. But the point God is making here is that it's not even so much what a person just, you know, people can say it. I heard Kenneth Hagin say this many years ago, you know, and I've never forgotten it. He said, we have a lot of conversions, but very few births. You go to a crusade ground. You know, I've seen this happen. You know, my wife and I have seen this. You know, I don't want to go into that story. You know, honey, remember Charles B. Miles? You go to a crusade ground. You know, and you come, tell people, everybody, put your hand up. Who wants to accept Jesus? You know, and then you now do a general prayer. You know, I believe Jesus died for my sins. And now, some of the people don't get born again. They say the words, but their heart is not in it. They do it sometimes because of, you know, emotional hysteria that is brought about by the crusade ground atmosphere and all of that. You know, some people, you know, they just, you know. So what is God saying? God is saying that the most important thing is the state of the human heart. The profession has its place because it's a spiritual law and a spiritual principle. I just got a text from heaven. He said, after that day, after that incident in house of Cornelius, when they got filled with the Holy Spirit, they got born again and filled with the Holy Spirit, without any sinner's prayer, subsequently they baptized them in water. You know, Peter said, who can deny water? And then they made a public profession. So the profession was still done. But it was done, you know, as an affirmation of what they had already gotten. This very, very important fact, I just saw it now. You know, they did make the profession. For instance, you and I are already born again. Do you understand? But even though I am born again, I still say, we even sang it last week. You know, I think Pastor Andrew and the choir sang it, you know, I believe Jesus is the Son of God. I believe he was raised again from the... It doesn't stop me from saying it over and over and over again. Anybody who believes Jesus is, you know, is the Christ, is born of God. We believe that he died for my sins, I do. You know, so although I've already been born again, every time I say it, it's an affirmation of what I already have. And that spiritual law still goes into operation. So that's what happened in Cornelius' house. God got them born again because of the condition of their heart. The honesty of their heart. And then after that, they got baptized in water, and subsequently they did say, you know, they believed Jesus was, you know, Jesus died for their sins and he was raised again from their justification. I'm saying that to say this, that affirmation is very important. We need to say it before we get born again, even after we get born again. I believe Jesus died for my sins and shed his blood, you know, for the cleansing of my sins. And I believe he was raised again from the dead for my justification. Those are the two things that are really essential things that get people born again. Believe Jesus died for your sins. His blood was shed for the remission of your sins. And then believe he was raised again from the dead. And every time you affirm that, two things happen. The blood goes into operation to cleanse your heart. And if you've been born again, to cleanse the connection between you and God. And if you're not been born again, it does it to, you know, to cleanse it the first time. Then eternal life, Zoe, the life of God, goes into your spirit. So it happens before you get born again. It also happens after you get born again. It's just that after you get born again, you're just getting more of what you already have. So, but the important point here is that what is really crucial is the fact that, you know, the heart, Cornelius already had an honest and a good heart. It was that heart that caused the word of God that Peter spoke, the seed, to find good ground. And when that word came upon Cornelius' heart, it was good ground, immediately brought forth fruit. So just like in the Old Testament, it was not circumcision that gave you faith. You had the faith before the circumcision. In the New Testament, it is not the word of God that makes your heart fruitful. It is the honesty of heart that which you've been exercising to the law of conscience. That's what makes the heart good. Then when the word of God now comes upon it, the word of God now brings forth fruit. It's very important we understand that. And that is why, when God is dealing with men, he doesn't deal with them based on their religious tags and professions. He deals with them based on the honesty of their heart. So you find God talking to an unbeliever who is not yet a Christian. In the Old Testament, you know, this was in a transition in Jesus' ministry. You know, wow, amazing statements in the Bible, but it's true. You know, he said to the centurion, he said, "I have not found so faith, great faith." Ah, but this man is not, he's not a Christian, he's not a Jew. Yet the Bible says that his faith was greater than the faith of the what gave it honesty of heart. The man just looked at Jesus and said, "You don't need to come to my house. I'm a soldier too. I said this one comes and it happens." He said, "I can see you have authority over the forces of nature. All you just say the word and my servant will be healed." The Bible says Jesus was amazed. What gave the centurion that kind of faith? Honesty of heart. He wasn't going to the synagogue. He was a Gentile. He didn't know the Bible. But faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So how did he get it? He got it by hearing the word of God through his conscience. Very important truth that we all need to hold on to. The other thing I mentioned, which I think is very important, was the fact that, you know, everyone say grace, say faith, say life. See, he says that it might be by grace through faith. See, grace is God's unmerited favor. But it gives life. We saw this last time, you know, in Psalm 30, I believe it is, it's verse 15. He says, "In his favor there is life." And then 1 Peter chapter 3 in the New Testament nails it down. He calls it the grace of life. So what grace does is that it makes available to you and I a measure of eternal life. Eternal life is not an experience of living with God forever. Eternal life is a substance, is the spiritual substance that's inside God that makes God God. You know, as the Father hath life in himself. So eternal life is what God has in himself. So what God did was make eternal life available to us by grace. And you can understand it because there is nothing you and I can ever do to inherit it, be rewarded, you know, to earn. Thank you, darling, for the English. To earn eternal life, Pastor Wally. But two English people, one born there, one studied there. Praise the Lord. You know, the English is better than mine. Okay, you know, to earn, you cannot earn eternal life. It has to be given to you by grace. And watch this. Eternal life, when you now get it into your heart through the confession of God's word and through prayer, you can then convert it to power that will now create anything you want. And that's where we closed last time, where, you know, I said that instead of what God did for us, instead of giving you a car and giving you a wife and giving you, money and all that, God gives you himself. Give the Lord a clap offering, somebody. He gives you his life. Then he says, without my life, you want a car, ask for it. You want a wife, pray for it. You create it. So those are those three words open up the operation of the New Testament. Everybody say faith, grace, and life. Let's say it again. Everybody say faith, grace, and life. It is by grace through faith. Faith is trusting God. When you have that trust in your heart, that honesty of heart, and you trust God, it causes God's favor to come. That's grace. Then that grace now gives Zoe. And then from there you can take off. Everybody, let's say it again. Say faith, grace, and life. If you can understand those three things, you can understand the New Testament operation. I was meditating all day, it's like yesterday when I was praying, you know, and God took me back to what I read many, many, many years ago from E.W. Kenyon. E.W. Kenyon had some wonderful books. You know, one of his books is called Two Kinds of Life. Another one, which, you know, I read was, you know, The Father and His Family. Then there's another one that's called, you know, The Bible in the Light of Our Redemption. He has two Bible study courses. There's a basic one, and then there's an advanced one. This is the basic one. The Bible is called, you can Google it. It's all the Kenyon Publishing Society still in operation till today. You know, it's called The Bible in the Light of Our Redemption. I can never forget, I was a young Christian when I first read those books, you know, and it's still fresh in my heart, 40 years later. You know what it says? He said, these two words open up the Bible, life and death. If you can understand life and you can understand death, you understand the whole Bible. What I've just told you now is a corollary to that statement. It was a grace, faith, grace, and life. And of course, there's death, which is just the opposite of life. You know, once you understand that, you open the New Testament. And you stop trying to do things by human, you know. So, now let's look at the operation of Abraham. Verse 17, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations before him whom he believed, even God who quickeneth, that word quicken just means gives life to the dead, and calleth the things which be not as though they were. See, when you understand what I've just told you, that's why I went through all this, that stuff again. You understand that it is Zoe, the life of God, that is the creative element. That is why a person with the life of God in his mouth can call what is not as though it is and it will become. Because the life of God in his mouth will create it. It's not lying. It is creation. See, it doesn't exist now, but I'm saying it exists. Now you're telling a lie, I can't see it. No, you will soon see it. Because what I have said has Zoe inside it, and that Zoe we create it. So God did not, watch this. God did not create the world out of nothing. He created the world out of Zoe that you cannot see. So the natural man says God created, he didn't create out of nothing. He created out of something that is spiritual and invisible. So everything you want, prosperity, healing, deliverance, life partner, you know, a new job, admission in school, that does not exist now. You can create it through the operation of your faith. You put the life of God inside you, then you speak God's word, confession, we're going to get that done in a minute, you know. Then you pray in the spirit, and then the angels will go and they'll create it. Initially, it will not be there, but it's there in the spirit. It's there in the life of God. It's not out of nothing. It's out of something. But that something is the invisible life of God. It's invisible to you, but it's real in the spirit. Oh! So you call the things which are not as though they were. Turn to your neighbor and say, start calling the things which are not as though they were. They will become because of the life of God that is in your heart. Who against hope? Oh, this stuff is good. Believed in hope that he might become the father of many nations according to that which was spoken. So shall thy seed be. Let me just, you know, comment on that just briefly. Abraham is 75 years old. God has called him out of what today is Iraq, Ur of the Chaldees. His background was a heathen background. His father and his people were worshippers of the moon and, you know, all kinds of occultic, demonic things. That's where Abraham came from. You know, in one of the scriptures in Deuteronomy chapter 26, when he was teaching out, he said, a Syrian ready to perish was my father. So, and that was Abraham. So now God calls him out and says, you're going to, you know, I'm going to bless you. I got a plan for you. I'm going to create a new nation out of you. And in you, all the nations of the earth are going to be blessed. But Abraham and his wife have had a problem having children. They are, you know, they've been trying. At this time, you know, because sometimes we read these things and we don't think that's where meditation comes in. I'm praying in the Spirit. Then the Holy Spirit begins to open up things to you that you didn't think of. He was already 75. He wasn't 60. He wasn't 30. So you can imagine how many years that they have been trying for a child. A 75-year-old man is already, you know, pretty old. So it's in that background that Abraham comes to God and says, look, I know you said all of this, but look, this man, this Eliezer is going to become my heir. I don't have any kids. We're 75. Sarah is 65 already. She's past menopause. This is Olubi translation. You know? And God said, chill. Olubi translation again. Cool. Take it easy, Abraham. Come. I'll show you something. So he calls him out and shows him the stars in the night sky. And he says, Abraham! And you know, you need to try it one of these evenings. Go out. Start counting. All of us need to try it. Just go out one of the clear nights where the stars and start counting one by one. Take a piece of paper and say one, two. It's an exercise in faith. You know, by the time you're done, you will know you haven't seen anything yet. Your eyes will start paining you. So Abraham did exactly that. And then God said to him, so shall your descendants be. So shall your seed be. Now here is a man who his wife is barren. They haven't had any children up to 75 years of age. So, because he knew who he was talking to. You know his name? El Shaddai. I am El Shaddai. The God that is more than enough. I am the God who is the creator of the universe. I'll tell you some of his other names. His name is El Elyon. It means the Most High God. So he was not talking to one funny fellow. He was talking to El Elyon. He was talking to El Shaddai. And El Shaddai said, so shall your seed be. So Abraham did the intelligent thing to do. Believe. When El Shaddai tells you, so shall your seed be, it will be an insult to say, how can it be? And that faith, God now counted it to Abraham for righteousness. Are you getting it? Okay. So he believed that he was going to have so many children, even though at the time he didn't have any. That is this operation of faith, and I'm going to summarize that, you know, before we close. So, and the Bible tells us, and this is instructive. That's why God inspired Paul, by the Holy Spirit to write it for our behalf. And being not weak in faith. See, so many of us are weak in faith. So God is teaching us how not to be weak in faith. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither the deadness of Sarah's womb. It's an instruction in faith. It's a lesson in faith for all of us. How many situations have you been in when it looks as if there is no hope? You look at the natural. Look at this COVID-19. Look at what it has done to the world economies. Even here in Nigeria now. All the things we used to trust in, God has kicked all of them from under our all the props. You know, okay, you normally get your money through school fees, or you get money through your business. The business is going to come in. This one is not happening. The place you used to look to before, that, okay, this one will happen, and that one will happen, and this person will do this, and this person will do that. Some of those things now, because of the ripple effect, the domino effect of what this thing has done to the economy, you know, there is a cascade effect. Because the guy who is supposed to do this is not doing this. This other one too is not doing this. This one other one is not doing this. This one other one is not doing this. So the normal thing we depend on has suddenly disappeared. But God has not disappeared. Hallelujah. You know what the Lord said to me? He said, lift up your eyes. Amen. I have not changed. Don't put your faith only in what you normally know. He said, I can use that. He said, but you have to trust me beyond what you know. You know what? I can still bring manna from heaven. He told me, he said, I can still bring water out of the rock in the desert. Don't limit me. Don't limit me. You know, we're so used to calculating how God does it. I mean, that's not wrong, because God does use, you know, God will not counterfeit money and rain it from heaven. But he doesn't have to counterfeit money. Amen. He can speak to the raven to bring food. He can open the windows of heaven and pour down manna. He can strike a rock and bring out water. All that is still available. And as we grow in faith, we're going to have to learn not to only depend on what we know. We also have to learn to depend on God, and when we cannot see anything. That was the kind of faith Abraham had. He looked at his body. I'm 100 years. Watch this. He faced the facts. See, faith is not foolishness. Faith is not presumptuousness. Faith is not a denial of facts. You don't deny the fact. My body is 100 years old. I'm past that age. Then he looked at Sarah, the wife. That's even worse. You know, you can imagine a 90-year-old woman, all the breasts and everything is already dry, you know, the stomach is in menopause, you know, and all the reproductive organs of the woman, they're all in the natural. There is no way. That's why the Bible says, who against hope believed in hope? God is allowing, watch this, I got a prophetic word for all of you. God is allowing the perils of the end time, like COVID-19 and others, to make us stop trusting in only what we can see. To move forward now, your faith has to move to another level, where you have to be able to trust God even when there is no hope. You know, when you are believing God for something, you start thinking, maybe if I call Pastor Lubi, you know, or I go and see Pastor Andrew, you know, and I talk to mommy ahead, they will give me something. Now, that's not wrong. And sometimes God may lead you like that. But when there is no Pastor Lubi, and there is no mommy, and there is no Pastor Andrew or Pastor O'Hare, and you are just in the desert, you now have to move your faith to another level where you can believe the invisible God without seeing anything. That's where God is taking us. And he's allowing these perils to come to kick the props that we have previously had confidence in, where our confidence now will only be in God. Give the Lord a clap offering, somebody. So he faced the fact, my body is dead. It's not physically dead, but dead as far as having children is concerned. Sarah's womb is dead. But God is not dead. Ha 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 ha! Glory be to God! God is not limited to Sarah's body. God is not limited to Abraham's body. You want to ask the question. And this is the question you should be asking yourself in your own situation. I don't know what your situation is. Who created Abraham's body? So the God that created Abraham's body, he can renew the body. The God that created Sarah's womb can renew the womb. So, Lord, I believe you. If you made the heavens, you made the stars, Abraham's body is not a problem. Sarah's womb is not a problem. That was the quantum leap that Abraham took. He took a quantum leap of faith from trusting in the natural to trusting in the invisible God. And he got a quantum leap of miracle. 100-year-old body. It happened. And I'm going to tie it to you and I in the New Testament in a few minutes. The body of a man who was 100 years old was supernaturally. Everybody shout supernaturally. I didn't hear you. I didn't hear you. Turn to your neighbor and say, this walk with God is a supernatural walk. Our faith is in a supernatural God. We have to learn to operate in the supernatural. See, we're so used to operating in the natural. Even the miracles we get, you know, God will use something natural. But you have to take the quantum leap and get to the place where you can trust God even when there is no natural link. Because you know what? God can create a link. I don't know if I'm talking to anybody here. By the time I finish this, your faith is going to skyrocket. Hallelujah. You know what? God preached it to me, so I got happy, then I came to preach it to you. Glory to God. Verse 20. He said, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief. Turn to your neighbor, say, bro, sis, don't stagger. It's easy to stagger. Ah, well, praise God, yeah. God is telling us the struggles Abraham went through. The temptation to stagger was there. Like, yes. The temptation to stagger was there. Hey, hey. You know, we Yoruba people say, hey, hey. Have you heard those? In our language, that means that God will not make you ashamed of your prayers. You know, sometimes there is doubt and unbelief behind those statements. It's not really faith. Well, it doesn't. You know why? We don't know God yet. Correction. We don't know God well yet. As much as we should. When you get to really know who God is, you come to know the fact that truly nothing is impossible. If it does not exist, he will create it. That's his forte. That's why he is God. He's a creator. anything in the natural you can use, He'll create it. That's where praying in tongues comes in. See, there is no way you can operate this faith thing and in the supernatural if you don't move into tongues. Because you cannot find language in the natural to express what you cannot see in the natural. Only God can put it inside your mouth. And that's why I have to do it through tongues. In the tongues of men and of angels. If I can't see anything in the natural, I don't even know what to say. I don't even know what to confess. Then the Holy Ghost takes over. Say, step aside, son. I'll do the confession. Hallelujah. I'll speak through you. And I will create through you what you cannot see that I can see in the realm of the Spirit. That's why you need tongues. I'm getting ahead of myself. Ah, glory to God. Amen. So he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith. Everybody say, strong in faith. Turn to your neighbor and say, you got to be strong in faith. And stay strong in faith. You know, many of us, we start out strong in faith. You go to Good Morning Jesus, you hear mommy make all those confessions. Your faith is strong, but by the afternoon, the faith has gone weak again. Amen. When you see all kinds of things, negative things that should not happen. Anyway, you know, there's an exercise, and that's what I'm going to tell you now. You know, to keep you strong, you have to keep that faith strong. Because it can go weak. Especially when you get evil reports. Or when you see things that do not line up with what you have believed. Then the tendency is, maybe it's not working. No! It's working! It's just working in ways you cannot see. So stop believing only in what you can see. But strong in faith, giving glory to God. Being fully persuaded, shout it out. I didn't hear you. You know, most Christians are not fully persuaded. And I like the word fully. You know, maybe you are persuaded a little. But you are not fully persuaded. You know how full persuasion comes? When you pray, meditate in the word of God. Then you come to the conclusion in your own heart. Not what Pastor Olubi said. Not what Mommy Sarah said. You've gone to the Word of God yourself. You have looked at it yourself. You've prayed. You've meditated. Then the Holy Ghost has put it inside your heart. That, aha, I am fully, God will do it. Then you come to a place of rest. That's faith. That's strong faith. Fully persuaded. That what God had promised, He was able also to perform. Give the Lord a clap offering. And you know what the Lord just told me? He said, tell them to give Father Abraham a clap offering. Give it to him. Father Abraham is not dead, though. He's not dead. He's in heaven. He's watching this. He's watching us from the video screen in heaven. And seeing what we're saying about him. God said, I should tell you that you should give. You know why? That's why God was so impressed with Abraham. Abraham had every reason not to believe. He was fully persuaded that what God has said, he was able also to perform. At two levels. He was fully persuaded that God was able to rejuvenate his physical body and Sarah's physical body. That was on one level. Then after Isaac was born, and God told him, go and sacrifice your son as a burnt offering unto the mountain I will show you. He was fully persuaded that if I kill this boy, God's going to raise him from the dead immediately. And the Bible says he received him that in a figure. If he kills him, is he not God? He will raise him up. Glory be to God. Thank you, darling. It comes through exercise. Over many years, that heart had become established in the integrity of God's word and his power. let me just stop there. I don't know. I won't come back to this next week. But I just want to quickly round up. Being strong in faith. I wrote it all down here. How are you going to be strong in faith? I like Romans chapter 12:12. Rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing stand in prayer. Then I'm going to add 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, where it says that rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks. If you put those two things together, two scriptures together, you get the operation of strong faith. And this is it. When you believe God for something, it could be money, it could be, you know, believing for a life partner, it could be believing God for admission into university, whatever it is. Firstly, you find the word of God that covers it. And there are so many scriptures, you know, I can just say, let's just use the simple one everybody knows. Mark 11:23-24. You know, whosoever shall say to the mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe the things which he says are come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he says. Therefore, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them. So, that covers so many things. You know, now, so you accept the God's word. And then you pray, you believe that you receive. Then you do three things. Number one, you continue to affirm that what you have believed and said is so. You see, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4, and I think in Hebrews chapter 10, it says, let us hold fast to the profession of our faith. These are the faith principles we learned when we were young Christians. Many of this generation don't really know most of these things. Because all these things aren't taught anymore. It's just taught is, you know, anointing oil and water and all this. You know, but the truth about the matter is that you've got to learn to hold fast. What does it mean? You keep saying what God said. You keep doing what Abraham did. You keep calling what is not as though it is. Now, it hasn't yet come to manifestation yet. But you keep saying. So you say, Father, I thank you, know. I'm going to get Thanksgiving in a minute. But Thanksgiving is a integral part of this operation. You keep, you know, saying, you know, by the stripes of Jesus I'm healed. If it's healing you're believing God for, my God will supply all of my need according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Whatever it is that you're believing God for, you know, you keep saying it. You say it with your mouth. And you believe it in your heart. Then you now to add praying in tongues on top of it. You know why? There are weaknesses. There are weaknesses inside your mind. Your mind, your will, and your emotions. Those, we call them infirmities, weaknesses. If you're not careful, after you've done it for some time, that confession can start to drop. Because you haven't seen the answer yet. Especially when there is a time lag between the time you believe you received and when you have it. That's where Christians fail. That's where patience comes in, what we talked last week. Let patience have a perfect work. You see, because if you don't fill in that gap with praying in tongues, you will find that I'm telling you this from experience of 40 years, you will find that your faith can become weak. Your faith can begin to waver because of the infirmities of the natural mind. Fear, doubt, you know, evil reports, you know, negative circumstances. But when you pray a lot in the Spirit, that's why I say building up yourself on your most holy faith. Praying in the Holy Ghost. That power of the Holy Spirit will strengthen you. Will strengthen those infirmities. That's on one hand. On the second hand, praying in the Spirit overcomes the principalities and powers that are hindering the manifestation of the answer. Daniel chapter 9 and 10. Daniel prays the very first day God sends the answer through Angel Gabriel. But the prince of Persia, you know, withstands him in the second heavens. So, but because Daniel continued to fast and pray, and he didn't give up, you know, that's why we should continue to pray in the Spirit. You know, the reinforcements were sent from heaven through Michael, the archangel. And then they came and fought with that prince of Persia, pushed them out of the way, and then the answer finally came. Spiritually, the same thing happens in every operation of faith. When you believe God for something and the answer has not yet come, keep saying it and then keep praying it.
praying in the spirit I'm talking about. That's where, you know, groaning, travail, you know, praying in tongues. And that's where you need the life of God. You need to put the Zoe, which is the fuel that makes praying in the spirit effective. That is that fuel now that you begin to speak out and you begin to pray in tongues that the angels will now use to continue to create in the realm of the spirit to make sure that what you have said comes to pass. Then you now add the third thing, thanksgiving. Thanksgiving. So every time that thing comes to your mind, that thing hasn't happened yet.
You know, that's the devil talking. You know, sit down there. That is not happening. You can't see now. You can't see anything. Nothing's going to happen.
Always answer doubt with thanksgiving. You cannot have a heart full of thanksgiving and a heart of doubt at the same time. So what you do say is just say, Father, I thank you, you're working on it. Father, thank you. Lord Jesus, thank you. Holy Spirit, thank you. Even though I can't see anything, I know you're working on it. I give you thanks. So you find that the operation of those three things, I would say confession of faith, praying in the spirit, and thanksgiving will keep your faith strong until the answer comes. Sometimes the answer will come in a day, like when Jesus cursed the fig tree. Sometimes it will come in 3 days. Sometimes it may come in 3 weeks, like Daniel. Sometimes it may take a longer time. It doesn't matter. Keep doing those three things. Confession of faith. Hold fast your profession of faith. Praying in the spirit. And thanksgiving. And you know what? It will come. As you pray a lot in the spirit, you are letting patience have a perfect work. All those infirmities in your mind, your will, your emotions that, you know, that God needs to deal with before the answer comes are being dealt with while the answer is coming. So when the answer finally comes, the answer will not become a God. It will not take your heart away from God, because your heart would have been established. Your heart would have been prepared through the process of operation of faith. Let us pray. Let's talk to God.
Now, we're going to continue our study in Romans chapter 4. In fact, what I'm going to do this morning, is to finish Romans chapter 4. We got to almost the end of it in our last lesson. And today, I'm just going to, by the help of the Holy Spirit, as He enables me, finish that. It is such an important portion of Scripture, because it tells us basically how God justified our father Abraham by faith. And the same principle that by which God used to justify Abraham by faith is the same principle by which God used to justify us by faith. But there's an extra thing I'm going to be sharing with us today, you know, which is the same way Abraham operated his faith in order for his physical body and that of Sarah's to be supernaturally transformed to give birth to Isaac. We are actually called to operate that same faith for the supernatural transformation of our own physical bodies. Now, that is a truth that has not yet been emphasized in the church. In fact, I brought a prophetic word many years ago, and it's been confirmed by other prophetic, you know, voices independent of me, you know, that Abraham and Sarah are a type of the end time Christian because of that fact. And that's why it says in Isaiah, I believe it is, chapter 51, it says, look to Abraham, you know, the rock, and Sarah, the rock from whence you were hewn. What were we to look for? The example of faith, but going further, the transformation of the body. Only Abraham and Sarah had that experience in the Old Testament, you know, as far as we know, you know, and it's going to be the, I'm getting ahead of myself, but it's going to be the, it should be, not going to be, it should be the experience of every end time Christian. When I finish, you will appreciate what I'm saying. Your destiny is the transformation of your physical body. And you can't get it any other way except you do it the way Abraham did it. Amen. So let's go back to Romans chapter 4. And what I'm going to do here, very briefly, as the Holy Spirit enables me, is let's again look at verses. We looked at verses. Let's start from verse 17, which was we did last time. We just quickly review it. As it is written, I didn't hear you, folks. I have made thee a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth, the word quickens gives life, to the dead, and calleth the things which be not as though they are. They were, who against hope believed in hope, that he might be the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. Being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither the deadness of Sarah's womb. I said this last time, it bears repetition. Faith is not a denial of facts. See, many foolish Christians want to deny reality, physical reality. Reality is at two levels. There's physical reality, there's spiritual reality. So you have to, you know, come face to face with the facts, the physical facts. His body was as good as dead. Sarah's womb was barren. Those were the physical facts. And then he now used his faith to bring invisible spiritual power to operate upon the physical reality and change it. And that's what we have to learn how to do by faith. You know, I said this last time also. You see, God did not create the world out of nothing. No. He created the world out of something, the life of God, the power of God, which is invisible. So it looks like nothing to the physical man. But it's not nothing. It's real. It's just that it is invisible because, I didn't say this last time, but I'll mention it now. I've taught on this over the years. We even teach in our foundations of faith classes. The difference in spiritual things and physical things is that spiritual things are operating at a higher level of power. I'm using that expression very loosely, you know, than physical things. It doesn't mean they're not real. And I use this illustration. I actually first heard it from Kenneth Copeland. Now, he didn't use the illustration I used, but, you know, I remember it was CAP meeting 1980, exactly 40 years ago. You know, about 40 years ago. It was sometime in July 1940. I went to Tulsa. I was a student then in Imperial College in London, and I went to Tulsa for the CAP meeting. It was a life-changing meeting. It was a destiny-forming meeting for me personally. And if I look back, I'm just mentioning this, by the way, you know, all the main leaders of the church in Nigeria were there. That time I was just a kid. I was only 21 years old. I didn't know who was who, you know. But Brother Emiko was there, and he took me by the hand and introduced me. That's when I first met Pastor Adeboye, you know. And I think Kumuyi was there. I didn't know who they were, you know. But he just said, oh, this is a young man from London, you know. And I said hello to everybody. That meeting, I can never forget it. Kenneth Copeland taught on life, light, and love. And he said this in one of the ministrations. But God had actually said that thing to me personally in England before I came. So it was a great confirmation to me. There were some flowers on the pulpit. So he said that, you know, he's not a physicist, but he used that illustration. He said, if you move this flower, you know, the way you see it begins to change. He said, if it moves above the speed of light, if I had enough power, it would disappear. Not because it's no longer there, but it's now moving at a realm, in another realm that your eye is seeing it. So when I was going to teach it, I taught it like this. If you look at the fan, if you look at a fan with its three vanes or four vanes, and the fan begins to rotate, the way you will see the fan changes. You don't see the three vanes anymore. You see a blur. It's not as if the three fans are not there, but because of the kinetic energy, now that's why I put my own part there, you know, because I have a physics background and the Holy Spirit taught me this and was confirmed by Kenneth Copeland, you know, if the fan begins to rotate and it rotates faster and faster and faster, the way you see it begins to change. You can see it even when it's rotating fast. You can't see three vanes anymore. You see a blur. If you did not know how many vanes were in the fan at the beginning, you wouldn't even be able to count them. It doesn't mean they're not there. They're just operating because of the energy in them. The way you're perceiving them, the way your physical senses perceive them has changed. Now, hypothetically, if you could rotate the fan faster and faster and it got to the speed of light, it would disappear. Now, that does not mean it's not there. It's just that it has shifted into a higher energy level that your physical senses cannot perceive. That's spiritual reality. That's why spiritual things are real. And we have a natural equivalent of electromagnetic waves. This room now is full of radio and television waves, my mobile phone, you know, those who are watching us at home. But you can't see any of those waves. You cannot see them, but they're real. They're moving at the speed of light. And because they're moving at the speed of light, they're not perceptible. It can go through your door. It can, you know, go through your dress and all of that. Yet, they're real. And we know that because you can see the effect of the mobile phone in the voice that you hear, the pictures that you see. Spiritual things are just like that. They are real. The life of God is real. The power of God is real. The blood of Jesus is real. You can't see them, but they're real. Now, if you put them into operation according to the spiritual laws, the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus, just like you put the physical laws of electromagnetics, you know, electromagnetism, you know, we call them Maxwell's equations. They're laws that govern the way, you know, electric and magnetic fields behave. If you put those laws into operation, you start seeing pictures on your mobile phone. You start hearing voices on your phone. In exactly the same way, if you learn to put, and that's what I'm going to just briefly round up now, you know, the laws of the spirit into operation in faith, just like those electromagnetic waves cause a reception in your mobile phone and in your television, you can see the effect of faith in your physical body. And it's based on laws, not sentiment. That's why we miss God. You know, it's like somebody, you know, his mobile phone is not working, or his iPad is not working. You know, he's not seeing the picture and all of that, you know, and it's because either he doesn't have enough power in it, or he's tuned to the wrong frequency. You know, the internet connection is not working properly. It's on, but it has a downtime at that time, you know, and so he doesn't see anything. Then he begins to cry, and he begins to roll on the floor, and he begins to shout, you know, and beg the mobile phone. The mobile phone will just be looking at him. He doesn't understand. He shouldn't be doing that. He should go and find out what's wrong with the connection. So it is spiritually. You see Christians crying and, you know, misbehaving all over the whole place. And so I'm going to find out what's wrong. There's something wrong with my connection. Nothing wrong with God. Nothing wrong with the transmission station. But there's something wrong with your receptivity. And that's why you're not getting the results. Having said all of that, using a natural illustration to explain the spiritual truth, based on Romans chapter 1, which says that the invisible things of him are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. I just give you such an illustration. The natural things of the electromagnetic waves, radio and television, they help us to understand the invisible things of God, you know, which deals with our faith. Now, let's go to faith. So here, he says, Abraham was not weak in faith, you know. He staggered not at the promise of God in verse 20 through unbelief, but was strong in faith. And that's where we stopped in our last time, you know, verse 21. And being fully persuaded that when he had what he had promised, he was able also to perform. Turn to your neighbor and say, God is able to perform what he has promised. Abraham was fully convinced. Now, many of us are not fully convinced. We're convinced, but maybe not fully. That God had the power to do what he said he could do. He was so convinced of it, he was ready to kill Isaac, knowing that God will raise him from the dead. Because God had told him that your children are going to be like the stars. And it's not through Ishmael, it's through Isaac. And yet the same God said, go and kill him. He said, okay, no problem. Aren't you God? If I kill him, you'll raise him from the dead. How do you get to that point in your life, in your Christian faith, in your walk with God, where you are fully persuaded? There are no shortcuts. My wife shared this last week. You know, it's by practice. Every time you act on the word of God and you get the result, your faith gets strong, more established. Because of your history, you know that the God who did that one, the God who did it, that's why faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Then it's not difficult for you to be fully persuaded he will do this one. You see, before Abraham had Isaac, you know, God, he had been walking with God.
The Bible says that Abraham was very rich in gold and in silver. So he had seen God move. So when God now told him, look, your children are going to be like the stars. He believed. Because the same God that brought me out of Ur of the Chaldees, Iraq, took me away from my father's people, and all their idol worship. The God who looked after me, the God who protected me. Remember how he went to fight with the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah, all those armies, he had great spoil. And then Melchizedek, the high priest, came to him and he gave him bread and wine and he gave him tithes of all. All of those experiences showed Abraham God's with you. Now, you haven't got the promise of Isaac yet, but you've got some promises, and that now convinces him. That's what makes you fully persuaded. If you're not walking with God, you don't get fully persuaded. You can't get fully persuaded just by reading a book, even though it's the Bible. You get fully persuaded by reading the Bible and acting upon it in faith and getting small, small results. Each of those results causes your faith to become more established. By the time you have a lot of them, you become fully persuaded. Is it clear? Having said that, let's review the operation of faith. I said this last week, and I gave us three things, but I'm going to add something else today, which I didn't mention last week. And the first one is, when you believe God, the Bible says, whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. Believing that you receive and having are two separate things. Believing that you receive means that you accept the invisible reality. It's not yet coming to physical manifestation, but you accept it as true, as an act of your will. That is what believing is. Now, there are things you have to do between when you believe and when you have. What are those things? Number one, positive confession. You have to start calling the things which are not as though they are. It's not a lie. You are affirming in the physical realm what is already true and real in the spiritual realm. And that, we call it positive confession. You find it in Hebrews chapter 4, Hebrews chapter 9. It says, let us hold fast to our profession of faith. That profession of faith releases a spiritual power, that invisible power that begins to create that reality. And it's already real, but it begins to translate it from the invisible realm into the physical realm. The second thing, and this is the one that's not emphasized, and this is where we closed last week, is praying in the Spirit. Praying in the Spirit is an integral part of our walk in faith. And you find that most, even our faith teachers, they teach confession, they teach faith, but they don't emphasize. Sometimes they just mention it in passing. The praying in the Spirit, and it's vital as a place in this operation of faith. Why? I mentioned this last week. Two reasons. One, the infirmities of your mind. That's why we doubt. Your will, your mind, your emotions, many times over time, if you do not strengthen and overcome those infirmities, which is what the Holy Spirit has been sent to help us to do, you will find that your faith will lag. It will get slack. It will get weak because of the infirmity. You've been believing for something. It's 3 weeks. Nothing has happened. That's what happens to many of us. When there's a delay where between the time I believe I receive and the time that the thing actually comes to pass. And I told us last week, you have different examples. Jesus spoke to the fig tree, 24 hours. Esther goes before the king, 3 days. Daniel, 3 weeks. Abraham, 25 years. Depending on what it is, some things take time. And the reason why it takes time is that during that time interval, God is working on you. He's working on the infirmities of your flesh so that when the promise comes, you will have, your heart would have been established to be able to receive the promise and it will not become a curse. Because many times, the very blessing God gives us is God who gives it, but because of the infirmities of the flesh, we make a God out of it. And that's why it took Abraham 25 years, because during that 25 years, God was working on Abraham. And he had so worked on him that Abraham had got to the place where if that boy came, that boy would not become a god. And he didn't. Because God said, go and sacrifice him, and he did. But if he had done it 10 years earlier or 5 years, he wouldn't have been ready. And that's why we have to understand there are many things God, he's not holding it back from us, but he's working on us so that let patience have a perfect work. I ministered this some weeks ago, you know, so that your heart is established enough to be able to receive the promise, such that the promise will not become a god, and it will not hinder you from your prophetic destiny. And that's why some higher things, when I say higher things, some more important things, God allows you to wait. Not because he's trying to stop, he's working on you. The second reason why you have to pray in the spirit is to overcome the principalities and powers in heavenly places. You know, typified by the prince of Persia. The angel told Daniel, from the day you prayed, God heard. The answer was sent. He said, but this wicked spirit, the prince of Persia, withstood me. That's why you have to pray a lot in tongues and groanings. It is the praying in the spirit that overcomes those two things. Your infirmities and the principalities and powers in the heavenly places that seek to hinder the physical manifestation of the promise. And that's why praying in spirit is crucial. You know, so we confession of the word, praying in spirit. The third thing I mentioned was thanksgiving. Throughout the faith operation, you should constantly be giving thanks. The Bible says the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name continually. So, and that's what helps you deal with doubt. When a thought of doubt comes to your mind, and it comes to all of us, it even came to Jesus. But I said, how do you know that? The Bible says he was tempted in every way like as we are, yet without sin. I know it came to him. The problem, the difference between him and us is that he never allowed it. He immediately comes, he pushes it out. Immediately came, it will push it out. You know? So when a thought of doubt comes, always just say, Father, I thank you. I know you're working on it. You see, and what does thanksgiving do? I didn't say this last week, but this is very important. Thanksgiving personalizes your faith. See, you can't thank a confession. You can't, even though you're praying in the spirit, because you don't understand what you're saying, you can't, but you can thank a person. And the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I've learned that now. I always do it in my heart, but God said I should start doing it outwardly to, you know, be an example to all of you. You know, when I pray in spirit, I say, Father, thank you. I always set the Lord always before me. I'm not just talking. I'm not just speaking to the air. I'm talking to somebody. So I thank him. Thanksgiving is very important. It causes, you know, that, and that's why Paul said here, he said, Abraham staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith. Giving what? Glory. Thanksgiving and glory is the same thing. You remember the leper. Jesus healed 10 lepers. And then one came back giving thanks. Jesus said, is it not? And it was a Samaritan. He said, well, not 9 cleansed. Only this one was found to come and give glory to God. So Jesus called thanksgiving glory. It is. So when you thank God, every time, and sometimes thoughts can come to you 20 times a day, 100 times a day. You know, always say, Father, thank you. I know you're working on it. I'm praying tongues. Father, thank you. I thank you. Lord Jesus, I thank you. Holy Spirit, I know you're working on that situation. And it will come. It will keep your faith buoyant. Now, the fourth thing I'm going to mention, I didn't mention this last week, is forgiveness. If you go and look at Mark 11, 22, 23, 24, you know, 25. Let's quickly go there. Mark. It's Kenneth Hagin's chapter. It's not Kenneth Hagin's chapter. It's Jesus' chapter. But, you know, it's Kenneth Hagin that made this, at least in our own generation here, you know, this very, very popular. You know, I quoted verse 24 the other time. It says, therefore, I say unto you what things soever. I didn't hear you, folks. Therefore, hello, somebody. I say unto you what things soever you desire when you pray, believe. When do you believe? When you pray. You receive them and you shall have them. There's a time difference between when you believe and when you have. Most Christians want what some of our people call lesekese. They want the thing to come in me. It doesn't work like that.
Because there is no place for patience to have a perfect work. The Bible says you have need of patience that after, not before, you've done the will of God, you may receive the promise. And that lack of patience is one of the things, Pastor G, that has caused a lack of character in the church. They want to take a shortcut. And it is through the operation of patience that your character is developed. Because that is God's character. The first thing God said about love is that love is patient and kind. And love is God's character. If you want to become like God, you've got to learn to be patient. And so, he says, you will receive them and you will then have the manifestation. And, verse 25, when you stand praying, it doesn't matter whether you're making positive confession. It doesn't matter, watch this. It doesn't matter whether you're making positive confession. It doesn't matter whether you're praying in the spirit to overcome your infirmities or to overcome the principalities and powers that are trying to hinder. Or it doesn't matter whether you're giving thanks. Whichever kind of prayer it is, whether it's positive confession, whether it's praying in tongues, whether it's groaning and travail, you know, whether it's thanksgiving. When you stand praying, forgive. Unforgiveness will abort faith. And that's one of the reasons why so many Christians are not getting answered to prayer. Unforgiveness. When you stand praying, forgive! If you have altogether. And you know, Satan sends these brethren to you and friends to offend you. And it happens to all of us every day. In the course of each day, you know, maybe what you should do is take a notebook, you know, and find out how many times you got offended yesterday. Then, you know, and draw the graph. You'll be amazed. And you'll notice something is when you really want to operate in faith, he sends somebody. Or a situation, or a circumstance that will cause you to be offended. Don't take the bait. Great peace have they who love thy law. Nothing shall offend them. It's the bait of Satan. Offense. What you need to do is do what Jesus said here. Observe, forgiveness doesn't mean you should cry or anything. He just said, when you stand praying, forgive. It means you can do it instantly. Matthew chapter 18 says, you know, forgive them from your heart. One, I have learned and I'm still learning it. I practice this now. I can't tell you how many times a day I do this. Sometimes 10, 20, 50, I don't know. I don't count. But it happens frequently. Somebody will say something or do something that will offend me. Immediately, I wasn't like that before. I've programmed myself and I'm still working on it. You know, immediately I just say, Lord, have mercy. Forgive them. You know, the Bible says it is an honor for a man to defer. I have too many important things to do than for me to allow what this person said or what they did to distract me from my faith. You got to learn that. You know, many times we don't even remember, you know, we're so consumed about, you know what they said to me, you know, that, and then you just got off the track of faith. Offense. It takes you off your end. That's what, Satan is Satan's bait. And, you know, it might be your wife. In fact, some of the people that are closest to you he uses. Or your children. Or your friend, or your colleague at work, they will just say something they shouldn't have said, or do something they shouldn't have done. I've learned now, I don't allow my feelings to dominate me. Even the forgiveness, I do it by faith, not by feeling. I don't forgive because I feel like forgiving. I forgive because I'm commanded to forgive. And it's instant. I don't wait. Instant. And how do I do it? I say, Lord, have mercy on them. Once I say that, I do three things simultaneously. I cause the blood of Jesus to go, because the Bible says, you know, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. It says, I'll have mercy. I'll be merciful unto their unrighteousness and unforgiveness. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 12. So immediately I say, mercy. Lord, ask life for them, you know. Instantly, I've learned and I'm still learning to do it. The Bible says, if you see your brother sin, say, ask life for him. You cannot ask life if you don't forgive. You know why? The unforgiveness acts as a block to the flow of the life. They you know, we're defining them now so you will understand them. But in operation, they operate almost simultaneously. So as I just say, Lord, have mercy. I forgive them. Instantly, I say it in my heart. That's why I say, forgive from your heart. And ask life for them. You know, and then, you know, I then deal with them with wisdom. You see, that forgiveness causes the life of God to flow from me to the person to help the person change, though they may not change immediately. And then for me personally, it enlightens my understanding so that I can know how to deal in wisdom towards them. See, it's not everything you fight about. It's not everything you talk about. Sometimes it's even wisdom not to even say anything. They may not even know they have offended you. Just say, Father, have mercy. You know, and then deal with them with wisdom. You know, you know that means no bitterness. You know, I use this illustration which happened in our church many, many years ago. We were still in Bodie International School. That's why I remember the example. There was a brother who was helping them. He was in the ushers. And he used to help them to count money at the end of the service. So one of the ladies who is also in the money counter, you know, both of them they're not in the church anymore. This is many, many years ago, you know. You know, and she put a substantial amount of money into the offering in a particular envelope. So when they were counting the money and they totaled the money, she noticed that the money she put was not there. And she knows she put it there. And she knows it was there when they started counting. Because she was the one who put it there. You know, so anyway, to cut a long story short, it was this brother who stole that money. It's a true story. You know, and put the money in his pocket. While they were counting, he just put that in his pocket. So the woman says, something is wrong here. So they came to report to me after the service. To cut a long story short, you know, the guy, because he was caught with his hand in the cookie jar. You know, so he couldn't deny because the woman, you know, so he now began to beg and cry and say his brother was sick and they had to go to the hospital and they needed money and that was why he did what I did. So, ordinarily, and I was much younger then and much more tempestuous. Well, you know, God helped me. You know, because I've all this First Corinthians thing, I've been doing it ever since 1980. I used to confess, you know, meditate First Corinthians every day. So that prompted me. God said, look, you have to forgive him. So I said, okay, I won't hand you over to the police, which I should have done. Or I could have done. You know, I said, no, I won't do that. You know, I said, what you did was wrong. You know, but I'm forgiving you. You know, if you needed money for your brother and was sick, why didn't you come to me? Say, Pastor, I mean, what I could have done, I would have helped you with. So anyway, so we forgave him. I didn't disgrace him. I didn't put him out of the church. I didn't tell. The only people who knew was probably maybe Pastor Boyega, one or two pastors, you know, and the woman who was involved. All other people didn't know. So what I now said, I said, okay, I'm forgiving you. This is how to deal with people with wisdom. But because of this weakness, you can no longer count money. That doesn't mean I've not forgiven. See, that's wisdom. And that's what you need to deal with people. That's why I'm using this very, you know, clear example. I said, you can't count money. Be in the church, you know, come, you know, and all of that, you know. And then I now asked about the brother, what was wrong with him, blah, blah, blah. And then we found some money, gave him, and we helped him. That's forgiveness. But wisdom, it would be foolish of me to put him at the place of money again. So, unforgiveness does not mean you don't remember. You know, people say forgive and forget. It's not biblical. I'll tell you why. I know God puts our sins in the sea of forgetfulness. Forgetfulness, what it means is that it is no longer reckoned on your account. Is this clear? And then there are two kinds of sins. They are the sins you commit before you got born again. All of those ones are completely wiped out completely. Because you were a sinner. That's why you're a new creature.
Let me give an illustration. I think I learned this from Kenneth Copeland. And this is what he said. He said, if a baby is born today, can you talk about what he did yesterday? This baby, he was born in the hospital 2 a.m. this morning. Then you now start talking about what the baby did 5 weeks ago. People say you are crazy. The baby was still inside the womb. The baby has not even been born. So there is no way he could have committed that sin. Your old man died. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passed away. That's why you can never be judged by your old life. A new creature was created by the Spirit of God. So everything you did before you got born again is wiped out. It's as if it never happened. Because as far as God is concerned, that old man stopped to exist. I don't know if we're getting it. Glory be to God. You know, these are new creation. Thank God for E.W. Kenyon. Give him a clap offering, somebody. Hallelujah. There's a book he has. It's called New Creation Realities. It's new creation. It's not a philosophy. It's not religion. It's reality. Before I got born again, the man I was before I got born again is dead. He was killed on the cross of Calvary. This new man came into being in 1979. Everything I did before 1979 is gone and gone forever. It is, my sins have been wiped away and put in the sea of forgetfulness. However, the ones I do after I get born again, they are recorded. Not to send me to hell, Jesus has paid the price. That's why your sins, if you continue in sin deliberately and you don't do something about it together, it can and will affect your eternal reward. That is why we will all appear before the Bema seat of Christ to give account. If they don't record it, how can you give account? That's why I say it's foolishness. This forgive, you know, forgive and God forget. It's not true. Not for the Christian. You know, he forgets in the sense that he doesn't hold it against you, especially if you truly repent and, you know, and all of that. You know, but it can have an effect on your eternal record. The good news is this. No matter how many bad things you may even have done, even as a Christian, if you continue in righteousness, let's say what the Bible says. It says that if a man hides, anybody who hides his sin, say he will not prosper. He that covereth his sin, who is dishonest about it. Cover doesn't mean, you can't cover it from God. God knows everything. So he's not talking about you. You can't hide it from God. He's talking about covering it from yourself. Being dishonest about it. If a man covers his sins, you know, the Bible says he shall not prosper. But he that watch these words confesseth and forsaketh shall have what? Mercy. So that's how it operates. If you after you get born again, if you commit a sin and you say, Lord, I'm really sorry, and you're honest and you're sincere, you forsake it, you start walking in the Spirit, using the life of God, the power of God, you know, the power of the Holy Spirit to walk in the Spirit, and so you don't fulfill the laws of it, and you begin to forsake it, you know, the frequency of your sins begin to diminish. What's going to happen is that the mercy of God will triumph over that judgment. Let's use accounting terms. What's going to happen literally is this. Even though you had some debits in your account, because you are now continuing in righteousness, the amount of credits you are putting inside the account becomes so large that the credit will completely obliterate the debits. They will be there, but they will be so small, they will be insignificant. That's why you should continue in righteousness. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? No. If you continue in sin, your debits will continue to increase. And when you now face the judgment seat of Christ, you will not go to hell, but you will suffer loss. And you don't want that. You want to get your full reward. That's why the Bible talks about a full reward. It said that you might have a full reward. Talked about in Ruth, talked about that in 3 John, you know. That you might have a full, so because you're going to be rewarded. Watch this. You're going to be rewarded not
by your faith, but by your works. But it's works by faith, actually, because it's supernatural. You know, you're going to be rewarded. I will give unto every man according to his works. I watch this. I am not saved by works. I'm saved by faith, going to heaven. It's only based on the finished work of Jesus and his blood. That's why the thief on the cross could go to heaven. He didn't even have a chance to forsake. Hello? He was already on the cross. He was already dying. He died maybe 10 minutes, 15, 20 minutes, or an hour later after he, you know. There was no possibility of him. That's why all this is true about restitution. Restitution has nothing to do with your salvation. You're forgiven because of faith. Finish. However, your reward can be affected by what you do. And will be affected by what you do. So that's how that business operates. So what you do is you forgive. And then you treat people, you ask for life for them, you ask for mercy. Then you now treat them with wisdom, you know, help them where you can. Have no bitterness in your heart. Whatever good you can do to them, you do it, you know. But with wisdom. There are some things, you know, that you just have to be wise enough to do. There's something that's just coming to me now. I'm going to say this just before I close. You know, one of the biggest mistakes David made, oh, Jesus help me, in his life, he made quite a number of mistakes. Of course, the one with Bathsheba was a really, really big one. But after that, you know, God forgave him. And, you know, although he never really got back to where he should have been. That's the thing about after you get to know and you do, you know, there's some things you just need to avoid. You know, his son Absalom actually had two sons. Well, much more, you know, but the two of them I want to bring out. One son raped his stepsister. Who was Absalom's full sister? What's the name of that fellow? Amnon, exactly. I don't remember his name. I don't remember those kind of names. You know, I think the sister's name was Tamar. Right. You know, so, and David didn't do anything. It's a big mistake. It was his not doing anything that provoked Absalom, but it did not justify him. It is never in your power to judge your father. He felt he would be a better leader than his dad. That his dad was weak. His dad should have actually killed Amnon. No. What Amnon did was wrong. What David should have done was to call Amnon, called and said, this is wrong, and go to the law of Moses. What does it say? Because you did this yourself, you must marry her. He should have, you know, taken the law to its full extent, you know, against Amnon. If he had done that, it might have pacified Absalom. Although what is Absalom's heart would still have come out. Absalom's a bad boy. So Absalom gets angry and kills Amnon. Mistake number two. You forgive. But you have to deal with things with wisdom. That's why we have the word of God. He killed his brother. If you kill somebody, you're supposed to be killed. So what David should have said is, arrest him. He's my son, but arrest him. Then call Nathan and some of the other elders. You know what the law says. He has to be killed. Then somebody go and preach to him so that he can be forgiven. You go to heaven. But the law, if he had done that, the rebellion would never have happened. And look at how many thousands of people still died. That's a lack of wisdom. So forgiveness does not mean you throw away your wisdom. That's why you have to go to the Word of God and find out what the Bible says. And then that's why you cannot really walk in love without the Word. So you will now know how to deal with the situation. Are you listening to me? This is what I'm saying is crucial. So many Christians are foolish
I forgive. Yeah, I've forgiven you. I've forgiven you as far as going to heaven is concerned. The blood of Jesus, that's all true. But if you say things you've done, then, you know, I have to use the wisdom of God to know how to deal with you. So that, like David's mistake, it will not pollute the whole nation. A little leaven leavened the whole lump. If he had dealt with Absalom and Ammon the way he should have dealt, he would have nipped that thing in the bud. Forgiving them, yes. But David was very sentimental concerning his children. That's one of the things that really affected him. There was another guy, what's his name? Adonijah. And you know what the Bible says? He says that never in his lifetime did his father ever say to him, "What doest thou?" David never even rebuked his children. That's wrong. Doesn't mean I don't love you when I rebuke you. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Not only will I rebuke, if I need to chasten you, I will chasten you. That's true love. Let me leave this. You know, just before I leave this, let me, you know, because we're talking about faith. But you see, faith operates with those things: positive confession, praying in the spirit, thanksgiving, and forgiveness. And that's why I'm dealing with this forgiveness right now. Because you have to learn, it takes wisdom to be able to know how to forgive from the heart immediately, the blood, life, and all of that. Then you now deal with the person or the situation with the wisdom of God. That's why I need the Word of God. What does the Bible say about this situation? How should I handle it? You know, God loves us, but that does not stop him from chastening us. There's a difference between chastening and punishment. The purpose of chastening is to correct so that they can bring forth fruit. The purpose of punishment is to make them an example to others so that others will fear and not do the same thing. And punishment only comes after chastening does not work. Hey, chasten. And the guy is not going to bring forth fruit. Then God brings out the big stick of punishment. Hell is a punishment. It's not a chastening. They're not going to change. They're going to be there forever. And their being there is supposed to be a lesson for others that you don't go to do something well. How do I get all of this wisdom? It's the wisdom of God I'm giving you. So I forgive, I chasten, you know, and if you keep chastening and chastening and chastening and the person, you know, is not bringing forth fruit and is not changing, then sometimes you have to bring out the big stick, you know, and do punishment. Sometimes punishment is not hell. Sometimes punishment can be premature death. Deliver him unto Satan for the destruction of the flesh. It'll be a lesson to the others. Then fear will come upon the church and everybody will behave themselves. I didn't hear amen. Well, you know, guess what? Turn to your neighbor and say, we're moving to that realm now. God, Jesus appeared to a man of God, one Jewish guy. I sent it to the whole church, you know, and said, I'm done with lukewarmness. We're going to now go, as the glory of God comes, we're going to see more chastening and punishments. And it's going to bring the fear of God back to the church. People will not want to mess around, which they've been doing, you know. God's been chastening. They don't listen. Chasten, you know, and they won't obey. Now, I got to close. Another 5 minutes and I'm done. And it is this. Abraham, Jesus help me, used his faith to transform his and Sarah's bodies supernaturally to give birth to Isaac. You and I, in the New Testament, let's go back to Romans chapter 4. We're going to close it. Romans 4. Have I helped anybody here? This Romans 4. Right. And we stopped in verse 22. Verse 21. Be fully persuaded. And therefore, it was imputed to him for righteousness. Now it is written, now it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead,
who was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification. In other words, the same way God justified Abraham by faith is the same way God justifies us by faith when we believe Jesus died for our sins and was raised again from the dead for our justification. Having said that, we're going to close with this thought. The purpose of Abraham's faith in this particular transaction was to change his physical body so that he could give birth, he and Sarah could give birth to Isaac. Our faith in Christ, what the Bible actually calls the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus, is to ultimately cause our physical bodies to be supernaturally transformed to manifest the fullness of the Son of God. Your body still has sin inside. Christ is in you. The body is dead. It's not physically dead. It's spiritually dead because of sin. But the spirit has life because of righteousness. And if the spirit of him raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, the raised Christ with this shall give life. So what God, all these years, that's why that one takes many years, just like Abraham's one took many years. To get the transformation of this physical body, you've got to keep operating these principles. You know, that's why you pray every, you know, daily, weekly, that Christ, you know, that you might be conformed to the image of Jesus. Now let's go to Romans chapter 12. I believe that's going to be my last scripture. And the Holy Spirit gave it to me this morning. You know, when he reminded me of it this morning, just those two verses. You know, I said, Lord, we've been reading these things for, I've been Christian 40 years, 41 actually. Now, you know, I've been reading the scripture, you know, and God showed it to me in a different way. Let's all read together. I beseech you, therefore, I didn't hear you, brethren. Turn to your neighbor, say, he's talking to brethren, not sinners. By the mercies of God, that you, turn to your neighbor, say, you who? You brethren, present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable, or some of the other translations say, your spiritual service. And be not conformed to this world. I say conform. But be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Now, I'm going to rush through this. You know, there's a message I'm preparing, but it's not for today. You know, where I'm going to be talking about, you know, insulators, conductors, and superconductors. You know, I'm going to use it as a natural illustration to explain the truth. But let me just quickly give this to you. There are three words here I want us to focus on. Everybody say conformed, transformed, renewed. I'm going to explain them in another minute or two. Now, this is it. When you get born again, your spirit is born again, but your body is not born again. That's why I said, brethren, you need to present your body as a living sacrifice. The ultimate purpose of God in this life is to transform this physical body. It is not a resurrection. It's still the physical body. And that's why Abraham and Sarah are the type. Abraham's body was still physical after it had been renewed. He still got tired. He still ate. He still slept. Hello? The transformation of Abraham and Sarah was not a resurrection. It was a transformation. Our transformation is a transformation. That's what Paul said in Philippians chapter 3. That I press toward the mark. You know, if by any means I might attain. They use the word resurrection wrongly there. The correct word is the transformation. The physical body is to be transformed. How? By the removal of the sin nature in the physical body. The life of God being made manifest in the physical body. So that it will conduct the power of God the way Jesus' body did it. It was because Jesus' body had the life of God inside it in great measure that the woman with the issue of blood could touch him and power could flow without Jesus' permission. How would you like that? I didn't hear any excitement. My goodness. Everybody say, oh, if you can't say amen, say, oh me. And say, God help my unbelief. That's where we're going. It's transformation. The body is to be transformed, the life of God manifests inside it, so that just from, like it was with Jesus' body. Can you imagine? Jesus' body was such a super conductor of the power of God. The Bible says that virtue went out of him and healed all. 15,000, 20,000 people. That's what God wants to do with you and I. But observe the process. Everybody say, transformed and renewed. Watch this. I got to close. It's getting so good. Amen. It is the renewing of the mind that becomes the avenue for the transformation of the body. If the mind is not renewed, it acts as a block. Until your thinking changes and you're thinking like what I'm preaching now, you can never have a transformed body. You don't even believe that the body can be transformed. You'll never get it. And you will never believe the body can be transformed if your mind has not been renewed. If light has not come from your spirit to your mind, your will, your emotions, that now becomes the avenue, the channel, through which the power and the life of God can then go into the physical body to transform it. And that's why he said, don't be conformed to this world. You're just, behave. You're born again. You're a child of God. But there's still envy, strife, unforgiveness, fornication, adultery. You're conformed to the world. He said, I don't want you to be conformed to them. I don't want you to be like them. Now, I want to transform you, but I cannot transform you without renewing your mind. So, as you renew your mind with the Word of God, revelation, knowledge, light comes from the Spirit into the mind, and the mind becomes renewed. It now acts as a channel through which the life and the power of God can go into the physical body to transform it. And watch this. I got to close. Once the mind is more and more renewed, and greater measures of the life of God is going inside the physical body, and the physical body becomes transformed. Watch this, Pastor G. The mind also now becomes transformed. Instant photographic memory. Language learning ability. Artistic. Musical. Mathematical. So the transformation will be at two levels. It will transform the body and it will transform the mind. Stand to your feet. Glory to God. Hallelujah. That's the faith of Abraham. The purpose of your faith ultimately is to transform your, renew your mind, transform your body and your mind. So it becomes like the Lord Jesus Christ. This guy who had this vision, one Jewish guy in America, I don't know the guy, but I heard him on Sid Roth and I sent the message around to people in the church. It's still available. If you haven't got, they can send it to you from the tape ministry. But I said tape ministry. Old habits die hard. Amen. The audio. We don't do tapes anymore. We do these, Jesus help me. Now, the man said he had this experience. He died, this man, and he went to heaven. So, Jesus said, when you get back to the earth, the proof that you had this experience is that you cannot play any musical instruments. The guy couldn't play. He's like me. That's why I'm waiting for the transformation of my body. One day, I'm going to tell all these organists, I say, move. Soon and very soon. They'll still be there, but, occasionally I'll just go and play. Now, what am I saying is that he played 14 instruments, and the guy couldn't distinguish do from la before. I just chuckled when I saw it. I said, God, you're just confirming, and that's just one aspect. Let's allow our minds to be renewed, and our bodies to be transformed, so that we will watch this. We will then be the full seed of Abraham. The ultimate purpose of God for Abraham was for him to have Isaac. The ultimate purpose of your faith is for your body to be transformed so that you can birth the Son of God. People can see the Son of God through you. Hallelujah. Let's talk to God because of time.
We believe these words have empowered you to live a victorious, transcendent life in Christ. Our mission is to equip God's people for service and build up the body of Christ until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ.